bet you anything, pi is the most famous figure in math, maybe after the number 1. If you take any circumference and try to figure the measure of its edge, you'll find that it always is 3 times its diameter and a little bit more. That number of times is the number pi. The thing is that knowing how much that little more actually is a real challenge. Greek mathematicians spent some time thinking about it, and even the Bible indirectly makes an attempt. And you could think it's easy, that you only need to draw some circles and measure them properly. This may be useful to get the first numbers, but you're going to get in trouble if you try to go further. Not only because measuring distances accurately is hard, also because every circumference that you draw, sculpt or model is going to be imperfect, even if its flaws are tiny. Never forget that perfect circles exist only in our minds, and that's where we have to solve this problem. And that's how, after centuries of brooding over it, mathematicians have found several methods of reaching this value without having to use rulers and compasses. In this video, I will show you how these 3 methods work. Besides, I'll also leave in the description 3 links to 3 codes, programmed and commented by me, so your computer can carry out each method. If you've never played with C++, you can also find complete instructions. But enough chatter, let's get mathematic. These are the 3 ways of knowing that pi equals 3.14159 and all the rest. The first method is based on the utilization of polygons, those flat thingies whose sides are equal. For example, this triangle is a 3-sided polygon. A hexagon has got 6 sides, and a dodecagon has got 12. I'm sure that you've noticed that the more sides a polygon has, the more it looks like a circumference. Let's exploit this. Let's calculate the pi of the polygon. This is the way used by Archimedes, Zhu Chong-Sidi, and Liu Hui. They started with a simple polygon, such as a square, and using their geometric superpowers, they calculated in each step the measures of a polygon with more and more sides. This means that if we end in an octagon, we will obtain that our pi equals 3.18, not the best result, which is normal. An octagon is not the best circumference in the world. But with 100 sides, we obtain 3.142. With 1,000, we obtain 3.1416. And if we get to 1 million sides, we will obtain 12 figures of accuracy. Check the code for more information. Let's go to the next one. This time, we will use random numbers, which is commonly known as a Monte Carlo method. This is how we do it. We build a square and draw a circle in it. Let's say that I try to divide the area of the square by the area of the circle. As it is well known, the square's area is its side, squared, while the circle's is the result of the multiplication of pi and its radius, squared. But it turns out that the circle's radius is the half of the square side. So you simplify the sides, and manipulating them, we obtain that pi equals 4 times the area of the circle divided by the area of the square. This means that obtaining the value of pi depends on our ability measuring these areas. Bad news, if we already had a hard time measuring the perimeter, imagine the headache of measuring the entire surface. We use random numbers for that purpose. Let's think the square is some kind of a target towards which we are going to throw some darts completely randomly. We know they will fall inside the square, but we are not sure if they'll fall inside the circle. Be aware of the fact that if I threw an enormous amount of darts, I'd cover the entirety of the square surface. There would be a dart in each point of it. Here's the trick. If I count how many darts are inside the circle and how much of them are inside the square, and then I divide these quantities, I'll obtain the same proportion I would obtain if I was dividing the areas. I'm measuring the surfaces using random numbers. Of course, you need to throw a lot of darts to make this true. The more darts we throw, the more accuracy we'll obtain. If we calculate pi using 50 darts, we'll only get the 2 first figures, while if we throw 10 million, we will get up to the 4th one. This is one of the disadvantages of Monte Carlo. Although it is great to determine very crazy areas, it needs lots and lots of random numbers to get far. As before, check the code for more details. And let's finish with the 3rd and the best one, the use of series. Normally, the addition of infinite things leads to an infinitely big result. But sometimes, surprising things like this happen. The additions of the inverses of the positives squared, 1 plus 1/4 plus 1/9, etc. The thing is that mathematicians realized that the more of these terms you add, the results tend to a very specific number instead of growing excessively. Knowing accurately the value of this figure was one of the challenges of the time, the so-called Basel problem, solved by one of the bosses in science, Mr. Euler. His conclusion was that the addition equals pi squared divided by 6. So we can take advantage of this peculiar method in order to obtain pi. The idea is adding as much terms as we can, multiply them by 6, calculate the root square, and we'll get what we wanted. Adding the first 100 terms, we obtain the two first figures. With 10,000, we get up to the fifth one, and we obtain the eighth one with a billion terms. I want to underline that this is not the only series leading to pi. There are lots of formulae in the mathematical world, some even more efficient than this one, that connect with this number. Connections from lots of corners of mathematics, not only geometry. And this is one of the oddest things about pi. It appears naturally without circles or circumferences around. But we'll talk about these peculiarities in another video. And you know, if you want more science, you just have to subscribe. And thanks for watching.